Father, we thank you so much for an absolutely gorgeous day. What a great opportunity to get together and to worship you. I thank you for those that are here and they're still making their way out here. Father, I pray we've missed this so much. You have provided ways for us to worship online and other fashion. And Father, we've been able to do that. And we thank you for that. But Father, there really is just nothing like being able to be together. So, Father, we pray that everything that we say and do will bring honor and glory to you, and that you will be lifted up today. Lord, we love you and we praise you. And most of all, Father, we thank you for Jesus, for it's in his precious name we pray. Amen. Let's worship.
Amen. As I was praying about what we should do today as we get back together, today I read a book by John Piper. It's entitled Coronavirus in Christ, and he made this quote. He said, "The same sovereignty that could stop the coronavirus yet doesn't is the very same sovereignty that sustains the soul in it." When I think about that and I think about the book of Job and what happened in Job's life, God's grace sustained him through all he faced. The psalmist was well aware of that too, because the psalmist said in Psalm 91, "Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust." So today, let's worship together and declare, "Blessed be the name of the Lord."
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will sing. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory. Your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Amen. Amen.
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou. Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. splendor of the King, clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, it trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. Age to age he stands, sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Amen. Let's give him a hand clap of praise. Thank you for his greatness.
things we all will stand in judgment for. Every single word that we have spoken, one of these days we all will stand before the Lord, give a reason for everything that we've done. And what I've done is trust in Jesus, my great deliverer, my strong defender, the Son of God. I trust in Jesus, blessed Redeemer, my Lord forever, the Holy One, the Holy One.
What are you gonna do when your time has come and your life is done and there's nothing you can stand on? What are you gonna say at the judgment throne? Well, I already know the only thing that I can say. I trust in Jesus, my great deliverer, my strong defender, the Son of God. I trust in Jesus, blessed Redeemer, my Lord forever, the Holy One, the Holy One.
There's nothing I can do on my own to find forgiveness.
It's by His grace alone. I trust in Jesus, trust in Jesus. Trust in Jesus, my great deliverer, my strong defender, the Son of God. I trust in Jesus, blessed Redeemer, my Lord forever, the Holy One, the Holy One.
Thanks, guys, man. Everybody that worked to put this together, this is no simple thing. With the sound and trailer and connecting to everything and so forth, and I really appreciate all of that. And I'll tell you something. I appreciate seeing you. For lots of reasons, not the least of which is preaching to an empty building is not fun. You know, they tell you to, first they say you're supposed to be normal. What's normal about preaching to an empty room? Nothing that I can figure. And so I tried looking around and that didn't work. And then I listened. They said, well, what you ought to do is you're supposed to look right at the camera. Well, that got old really fast. So then I decided I'd try the outside thing. And by the way, I want to tell you something. That Easter service was a miracle because that was several things that came together. And, excuse me, Gera put that together. And then we sent it on to the powers that be that got it on the website. But I received a phone call from my son, my youngest son, that night before it went up, and he said, "Dad," I said, "Yeah." He said, "Do you know there was a spider web floating in front of that camera?" To which I said, "You mean to tell me out of all that, that's what you got? A spider web. Wow." yeah, it's been a little, it's been different, but it's so good to see you, and to see you at a distance, to see your vehicles. That's nice, actually, too. So, and if anybody's passing out snacks, I hope you brought some for everybody. That's all I have to say. So, take your Bibles or your iPads or your cell phones or whatever you've got and turn or go to 1 Kings 18. And my prayer is while we look at this is that it does not start raining. You'll understand why in a minute. So, 1 Kings 18, while I play the wind game on my Bible here. 1 Kings 18, we're going to begin in verse 41. It says, "And Elijah said to Ahab, 'Go up, eat and drink, for there is a sound of rushing of rain.'" No, just in the scripture. "So Ahab went up to eat and to drink, and Elijah went up to the top of Mount Carmel, and he bowed himself down on the earth and put his face between his knees. And he said to his servant, 'Go up now, look toward the sea.' And he went up and looked and said, 'There is nothing.' And he," meaning Elijah, "said, 'Go again.'" Seven times. He didn't tell him to go seven times. It's just this played itself out seven different times. "And at the seventh time he said, 'Behold, a little cloud like a man's hand is rising up from the sea.' And he said, 'Go up and say to Ahab, prepare your chariot and go down, lest the rain stop you. And in a little while the heavens grew black with clouds and wind, and there was a great rain. And Ahab rode and went to Jezreel. And the hand of the Lord was on Elijah, and he gathered up his garment and ran before Ahab to the entrance of Jezreel." Father, as we come before your throne of grace today, we give you praise and honor and glory. We thank you for allowing us to come together again. Father, what a blessing it is to see people. What a blessing it is to be with brothers and sisters in Christ. I know there are so many ways that we have learned to worship you in the last few weeks. Father, there is nothing like being together. Thank you for that. Just bless now, Father. Speak to us as only you can. For it's in the precious name of Christ we pray. Amen. You know, when I was growing up, watching what little TV there was there, I remember there were three channels when I was in Dallas. And they were black and white for the most part. I can vaguely recall when color started hitting. You thought the world had come to an end. It was really an amazing thing. I know that's hard for some of our younger folks to understand, but that's okay. Later on, I'll introduce you to a rotary dial telephone, and you'll get the idea. But, you know, I grew up watching the Three Stooges. There you go. And I grew up watching the Munsters and the Addams Family and things like that. But, you know, there were some characters on TV that were larger than life. There was Daniel Boone. You know, I know we're not going to sing that song, but I guarantee it's going through your brain right now. You know, Daniel Boone was a man. Yeah, he was a big man. Yeah, used to watch that. I remember that. I remember Perry Mason. Perry Mason, within an hour, would solve the case, and he always got the person to confess. It was incredible. And then, of course, there was the Lone Ranger. Yeah, that guy that jumped up and down on that horse, man, that was incredible. Those were larger than life kind of people. The Bible is full of characters that are larger than life too. You look back in the Old Testament, you read about David, and I know King David did so many things, but growing up, I remember hearing about King David and Goliath. How could you not know about David and Goliath? Or there was Samson, and of course there was all Samson's exploits, but you couldn't hardly have Samson without connecting him to Delilah, I guess. There was Joshua. Joshua was an amazing leader, but you immediately connected him with Jericho. And there was Daniel in the lion's den. But then there was Elijah. Elijah was, if you will, the first great prophet, so to speak. And you can't help but connect Elijah to Ahab and to his wife Jezebel. Now, I'll give you a little background to this. We were now dealing with a split or separated kingdoms. There was the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. There was Israel. And Ahab is the king of Israel. Now, Ahab was the king of Israel for many years, over 30 years. He was not a godly man. His wife Jezebel was a priestess of Baal. She certainly was not a godly woman. And this was the kind of leadership that Israel dealt with. This was the kind of leadership that God sent Elijah to. Now, there came a point in time where God sent Elijah and told him that that he was to say to the king, there would be no more rain until he spoke again. Now, in James chapter 5, we're told what took place. In 5:17 and 18 of James, it says, Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And for 3 years and 6 months, it did not rain on the earth. Now, if you follow the rest of the story through 1 Kings 17 and 18, eventually that's what leads to Ahab sending out people looking for Elijah. He comes back. There's that great challenge on Mount Carmel. And when we come to 1 Kings 18:41 that we just read a few moments ago, we've just completed one of the most amazing stories that you'll ever read. You have the story of Elijah on top of the mountain, Mount Carmel, the place where they were supposed to worship God, and he's up there facing 850 prophets of Baal and the Asherah. It is a challenge. Whose God is God? We're going to decide. So it's 850-1. At least that's the way they think. The reality of it is it's 1-0 on Elijah's side, obviously. But it was quite an experience because here are these prophets and they're going around and doing all these different things trying to get Baal to respond. And, of course, Baal doesn't exist, so Baal isn't going to respond. But if you remember, Elijah taunts them. He says, well, you know, maybe you ought to shout a little louder. Maybe Baal's asleep. Maybe you ought to jump up and down. Maybe he's on a vacation. Or maybe you ought to beat yourself a little bit. He could see how serious you really are. So they go through all these different things. This goes on all day long. And finally, basically says, you know what? You've had enough. You've had enough time. So he goes and he rebuilds the altar of God. And he puts wood on it. And he puts a sacrifice on it. And then he calls them to bring water. And they're to bring water. And they pour water all over the sacrifice. He tells them to do it again. He tells them to do it again. And by this point, there's so much water running over the sacrifice. And over a trench that's been dug that it fills up the trench. And Elijah prays. Basically, he says, Father, so they will know that you are God. That you are the only God in Israel. Show your glory. Fire comes down from heaven and boom. Ignites the fire, burns up the sacrifice, burns up the wood, burns up the stones, laps up the water, and all Israel sees it. Well, after that, the priest or dealt with. I'll just leave that at that for your further reading. Elijah, though, tells Ahab, you better get ready to roll because I hear the sound of rain. After 3.5 years with no rain, now Elijah says, guess what? It's going to rain. And then when you look at verse 42, you see this man who goes, you know, Ahab goes to eat as Elijah has told him, and Elijah goes back up on the mountaintop, and he assumes this position of prayer. Now, we've seen the glory of God in the fire, but we're about to see the glory of God in the cloud. Now, I know what you're going to think. You're going to say, now, wait a minute, preacher. We've been on this glory thing for a long time, and this time, this is a stretch. But it's not a stretch at all. In fact, look how well it comes together. The context sets it up. Because first we had the fire, and we're about to have a cloud, and it is literally the perfect picture of the Shekinah glory of God. First you get the power of God, then you get the provision of God. Now today, we're going to focus on the glory of God in His provision and how Elijah accessed that provision through prayer. Remember James? He prayed fervently that it might not rain, and for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the earth. But let me finish that verse. Then he prayed again, and heaven gave rain, and the earth bore its fruit. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, but wait, Pastor, I mean, that's Elijah. I mean, Elijah's one of those larger-than-life guys. I mean, you know, there's Daniel, and there's David, and there's Samson, and so forth. But don't forget that James, that verse begins this way. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours. No matter what you think of him, he was a man just like you and me. With a nature like ours. He was a man just like you and me who learned to trust the one and only God. So the question is, how did he do that? He prayed. Number one, James tells us he prayed fervently. You may have a version that says he prayed earnestly in James chapter 5. It means the same thing. It literally means he prayed in prayer. It doubles up. He prayed in prayer. He kept on praying. Have you ever heard some or ever said to somebody, man, you really need to bear down here. Or you really need to focus on this. You really need to get things together here. I've helped folks. I remember helping somebody get his truck. It had died in the middle of an intersection. And I jumped out of my vehicle and a couple others got out. And we started trying to push that thing. And it was a big old half ton. And I remember someone yelling out, come on, push like you mean it. Well, that's kind of what this means. He prayed fervently. He prayed like he meant it, if you will. It says he spoke to Ahab, I hear the sound of rushing rain. After 3.5 years, there hasn't been any rain, much less a sound of rushing rain. So really, what you remember what stopped it to begin with? His prayer. Elijah's prayer stopped it to begin with. The word of God through Elijah. In 1 Kings 17, it says, I serve the Lord, the God of Israel, Elijah said to Ahab. As surely as the Lord lives, no rain or dew will fall during the next few years unless I command it. Well, guess what? He's just commanded it. He's just said it's about to happen. So, now, here's the thing, though. You have to understand, Elijah realized he's not the source. He's not the source of the drought. He's not the source of the rain. God is. So, as surely as he prayed to God for the fire, he's praying to God for the rain. Zechariah 10 Verse 1, God says through the prophet, ask rain from the Lord in the season of the spring rain, from the Lord who makes the storm clouds, and he will give them showers of rain to everyone, the vegetation in the field. Now here's the picture. It says he prayed fervently. This is what it's not a picture of. It is not a picture of praying flippantly, of praying kind of like in passing. You know, I've been caught several times. I've had people, we were talking about this service and we're going to have a drive-in service. I've called it a drive-through service. I accidentally called it a drive-by service. I've called it about everything other than a drive-in service, okay? I'm sorry. That's just me trying to remember what it is. But, you know, there are a lot of things that we do in passing. we kind of do flippantly. We do, or we may say, well, we just kind of matter-of-factly do thus and such. Understand, that's the exact opposite of what's being described of Elijah here. God's glory, his provision, is coming because Elijah is praying, and he's praying fervently, not flippantly, not passing, not as a matter of fact, but he's praying in a way that recognizes the Creator, the one who not only created all things, but who controls all things. James chapter 4, James says, you have not because you ask not. I wonder how many times we have not because we ask, but we ask while passing. We ask in some flippant way. We ask while we have a moment, or we ask as if God is somehow obligated. And nothing could be further from the truth. Not Elijah. He speaks the word of God, but he prayed fervently. Not only did he pray fervently, he prayed believingly. And yes, it is a word. I looked it up. Verse 42 talks about this position he puts himself in. And no, Elijah was not a practicer of yoga. That's not the point here at all. The picture is of someone who is contorting himself into a position to where he is totally physically cut off from everything from the outside, to where basically all he can see is the back of his eyelids. That there are no disruptions, no distractions. He wants to focus on God. He's going to pray believingly. Now, you may say, well, but my goodness, why wouldn't you believe? I mean, he was just up on the mountain and just saw fire come down from heaven. I mean, that'll be enough to make anyone believe anything. But consider, it had been 3.5 years since a drop of rain had fallen. That's quite a drought. Secondly, it says he went up on Mount Carmel. Mount Carmel is about 470 feet in elevation, approximately. It would give you a great view of the Mediterranean Sea. But he doesn't turn himself to look at the Mediterranean Sea. He puts himself in a position to where all he can do is focus and believe on God. Elijah refuses to look at this beautiful view. He refuses to look out and see when the cloud will be coming. Instead, he sends his servant time and time and time again. Why? Because he's occupied with prayer. He's praying believingly. He's praying in a way, it's a picture of being self-abasing, of seeing nothing else but the one you're focusing on. This last week, I did something that I was really kind of surprised I would do. For those of you that keep up with professional football, you know this last week was the annual National Football League draft. Now, if you watched any of it, you know it was totally different than it's ever been before, because it's always held in some big convention center. Everybody's all together. All the teams are together and so forth. Of course, none of that happened because of the virus situation. So you have all these teams, and each team, they had different cameras. Some cameras were at the owner's home or office. Others were at the coach's home or office or the general manager. And then they tried the best they could, and they had to do a lot of work to do this, to figure out who all the players were that really had a possibility of being drafted. Being drafted on that first day, being drafted on the second day or third day or whatever, so they could have links to them. So when they got that phone call, you know, they could get that expression of the family and so forth. And so they had all this set up. And it was interesting watching, and I don't normally watch that stuff. But I did. I didn't watch it all, but I turned it on. Okay, I have a confession to make. Yes, I did watch to see who the Dallas Cowboys drafted. Okay, I feel better now. But it was interesting because when their first draft pick came up, they have a new coach, a new philosophy, a new plan. So, you know, they were looking for someone to fill a particular position. But when their first position or first draft pick came up, someone came up that they didn't believe would still be there, still be available. And they went out and they drafted that player knowing full well he didn't fit the profile or anything else they were looking for because they felt he was too good to let go by. He was certainly too good to let anybody behind them who were their competitors get. So they drafted this fella. So after they did that, then they brought on this screen, kind of like our men's Zoom conferences have looked like the last few nights. You had all the experts, and they're all talking about this player, and here's what he does, and here's what he brings to the table. He runs the 40-yard dash in this speed, and he caught this many touchdowns in college, and he caught this many touchdowns in high school, and here's the way they can use him, this and that and the other, and it all had to do with what he brought to the table. We talked about that in our Sunday school class this morning. I want you to understand something, folks. When it comes to us and God, we bring nothing to the table. Nothing. We don't run the 40. We don't catch touchdowns. We don't do good things. There is not a thing in the world that we do. God brings it all. We bring nothing. So you better be praying believingly, because it's not going to be based on anything that you've ever done. That's what Elijah is doing. Elijah knew, though he spoke the words, he knew it was not his words that commanded the rain to stop or the rain to come. He knew that it all came from God. It wasn't about Elijah. It wasn't about Ahab or Jezebel or even Israel. When all was said and done, it was and is all about God. God is glorified by providing for his children. So Elijah prayed fervently. He prayed believingly, and he prayed persistently. If you look at verses 43 and 44, how many times he sent his servant back? Seven times. You know, it's amazing how often that number seven pops up in Scripture. Seven times the army of Israel marched around Jericho. Naaman is told to go and dip seven times in the Jordan, time and time and time again. Seven times, does it mean a literal seven? Yes, but it also means the right amount of time, whatever the right amount of time is. It means not giving up. It means not walking away. Elijah prayed persistently. Now, there's three things I want to point out here real quick with this, and what you'll see what this points out. Number one, he cut himself off from everything except God. He goes up on Mount Carmel. He walks back up. He's separated. He's at a very high, very private place. He's going to receive hopeless reports. He knows he is, but he's going to keep on keeping on. Have you ever noticed how we get discouraged by sight so often? If he had been looking out and praying, who knows what kind of effect that might have had on him. He cut himself off from all of that, and he focused totally on God. You know, the writer of Hebrews says in Hebrews 11:1, now faith is assurance of the things hoped for, the conviction of things what? Not seen. And that's exactly what he's doing. Learning to trust only the one who could provide what he needed. Here's the second quick thing. The answer may not come quickly, but we don't quit. We don't give up. You keep on keeping on. So many Christians pray like I fish. It's not a good thing, let me tell you. I can catch fish if I really want to, but I'm not a fisherman, because when I go out, I want fish. I want a stringer of fish, and I want them in 15 minutes. That's just the way I think it ought to be. And if I don't have fish in about 15 minutes, I've pretty well had all I can handle of it, and I go on. A lot of Christians pray like I fish. That's not a good idea. That's not the way that Elijah was praying. He was going to keep after it. He wasn't going to quit. Even the delays in our prayers sometimes, the delays in that answer become part of God using us. You know, Martin Luther, who was one of the founders of the Reformation, as we've been talking about, the solos of the Reformation. He made a statement one time. He said, you know, I have so much to do today, I'm going to spend the first 3 hours in prayer. Now, I don't want you to go home and feel terrible because you're not getting up at 3 in the morning to pray. That's not my point. Wouldn't have been his point either. his point would have been, and my point is, we have to give greater weight to prayer than we do, because it is our connection to God. Because that answer may not come quickly. It may not be, I prayed this prayer one time and that's all she wrote. He kept sending his servant back because they didn't see anything. He kept praying. He cut himself off from everything except God. The answer didn't come quickly, and so he kept after it. But here's, don't miss this. Never despise small things. We live in a culture that tells us go big or go home. Well, what does it say? That seventh time, the servant came back and he said, you know, I see a little cloud. It's about the size of a man's hand, man's fist. Now, I don't think that was one of those visual optic things that they do on the internet now. You know, they throw the thing up, and it's, you know, it's all W's, and if you can find the M on there, you're a genius. Or if it's moving, if you look at this, it moves this way, but if you look at that one, it moves that way. You know, so it was just because he was at a bad position, and so it looked like the fist of a man, but if he'd have moved over here, it would have been bigger. No, he described it exactly the way he saw it. He saw a cloud, size of a man's fist. That's pretty small. That's pretty small. Now, I want you to look at what God is going to do through that. They're right near the area where the Kishon is. And it floods pretty easily when heavy rains come down. And Ahab is still there. He's not right there with Elijah, but he's still there. And Elijah tells his servant, you better go tell Ahab, he better get a move on. Because he's going to get caught. Storm's coming. How that little fist. That little fist. The glory of God. It's not about how big the cloud is. It's about the God in the cloud. And that's what's about to happen. In verse 45, it says, and in a little while the heavens grew black with clouds and wind, and there was a great rain, and Ahab rode and went to Jezreel. The rains came so fast they had to run for it. Literally. And then comes one of my favorite passages. Here's Ahab, and the only reason he's getting out of there in one piece is because Elijah warned him, told him. You think he could have had the decency to let Elijah get in the chariot with him? He doesn't. He just takes off. And it says that God's hand was on Elijah, and he ran past the chariot all the way to Jezreel. Now, let me give you a picture. Do you know how far it is from Mount Carmel to Jezreel? 17 miles. You know, I talked about some of those TV shows I used to watch when I was a kid. I used to watch a show called $6 Million Man. That was long before they had all those special effects. They just made weird noises. Made you think things were happening. You know, and he'd move in slow motion, but supposedly he was moving really fast. Well, I want to tell you something. $6 Million Man got nothing on Elijah, because God had his hand on him. The results of persistent prayer are unmistakable. God provides because it glorifies him. I knew a fellow not too many years ago in Crossville, Tennessee. His name was Michael. He met his wife, Julie, at a Bible study where there were 30 or 40 people that would gather together every Friday night, and they'd sing, and then they'd break into small groups, and they'd come together for fellowship afterwards. And Michael became part one of the praise group folks, regular musicians in the group. And he played an old guitar, and he was beginning to think about getting a new one. A friend of his in the Bible study had two really nice guitars, and so he lent him one of them. It was the nicest guitar, he said, that he had ever played. And that thing was amazing. He cherished that thing as if it was a newborn child. Now, I know that may sound kind of strange, but any of you musicians, you'll understand. He cared for that thing. He was careful not to bang it into things. He gently wiped down the strings and the body after he was playing it. And he tenderly, carefully placed that guitar in that velvet-lined case every time. He worried about things like the humidity of the room where the guitar was being kept. He borrowed that guitar for months, and he was thinking about buying it. But in the meantime, he and Julie got engaged. As their wedding was approaching one day, Julie came to him, and she said, simply said this. She said, "The guitar is yours. I bought it for you weeks ago as an early wedding present." Well, his first reaction, he said, it was just ecstasy. Man, the most beautiful guitar he had ever played, and it's his. Suddenly his. And then his second reaction was relief, because now, since it was his, he could stop babying the thing. He didn't have to treat it so gently or clean it so carefully. And then Julie turned and said something to him. She said, "Then again, isn't it really God's? Shouldn't you take good care of it like you did when it was yours, but you didn't think it was yours? All that time, what he'd been doing was something called stewardship. It was the fact of taking care of something that we have that is on loan from someone else, because the reality of it is everything is on loan to us from God. Everything. Everything we have, even the very breath that we draw, is on loan from God. It's provided by Him. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, but he prayed. He prayed fervently. He prayed believingly. He prayed persistently to glorify God, to point to God, so that everyone would know that everything that they were ever provided was given by God. Let me ask you a question. Shouldn't we all do the same? I mean, after all, doesn't it all belong to Him anyway? Father, You love us so much. You have provided everything for us, all the way down to Your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross and bore our sin. Father, the very breath that we draw is from You. How much we thank You and praise You for that. I pray that we will never take it for granted, that we will never take You for granted. Father, may we be people of prayer, people that realize that You are glorified by providing for us. And that in turn, Father, we access those provisions by praying fervently. Believing me. Father, we glorify You by pointing back to the One who gives us everything. Father, the freedom to gather is not granted to us by a government. It's granted to us by You. Freedom to worship by You. The freedom to sing. Honor and glorify You by You. Father, I pray for anyone here today who does not know Christ. Anyone here today that before they came did not understand that Father, when we do leave this place in a few moments, we pray that as we go back out into the world, that you would use us to make a difference, and that people would see that it's, Father,